I want to begin by echoing the sentiments already offered of thanks to Jonathan Fanton, whose leadership and support for this effort have been exemplary, my co-chair, Roger Ferguson, and especially to the members of the commission, many of whom are here today, who were consistently hardworking, deeply thoughtful, and mutually respectful. I mean, the commission meetings were really a model of serious civic discourse, a kind that I think we would love to see replicated much more widely in our society than it is today. More than anything else, I think, certainly for me, and I think for all of us on the commission, the experience of participating in this effort was one of learning. You know, I've spent a career studying higher education, but when you take on as inclusive a project as we did, ranging across the full body of undergraduate education in this country, you realize the variety is infinite, in many ways inspiring, the variety both of institutional types and of student needs, perspectives, capacities, and dreams. So I think we were all learning as we went. I'm going to try to give you some idea of how the report came to hang together in the form that it did. And then I'm going to invite my three colleagues sitting to my left, your right, to bring their own perspectives and insights to what was in the report. So let me introduce them. I will try to make this as formal as I can, but I will also make it brief. In the order in which they'll speak and in which they are seated, we have first Mitch Daniels, who is the president of Purdue University in Indiana, the former governor of Indiana, and of course a leading figure earlier in administrations as the director of OMB and in other important roles. Is that enough of your honor?
More than enough.
We're very glad to have had him on the commission and to have him with us today. To Mitch's left is Deborah Ball, who is the former dean of the School of Education at the University of Michigan. She is also the founder of an organization called Teaching Works, which is an innovative effort housed at the University of Michigan to make deep improvement in how grade school and high school teachers are prepared for their very demanding work. And I believe that Deborah is currently the president of the American Education Research Association, among many other both demanding and honorable titles she has held. To her left is Jack DeGioia, who has been the president of Georgetown University for 17 years and is still smiling and even a little tan, I think. And before that, served in other posts at Georgetown. And I think he said has been at Georgetown for 43 years, which means he arrived as an undergraduate when he was 6. So this is a wonderful panel of people I think of as friends, and I will hasten to give you an opportunity to hear from them shortly. So as Roger said, this commission focused on three major priorities. And of those, two of them, college completion and college affordability, are absolutely crucial, but also relatively familiar in public discussion of higher education in this era. impelled by, among other things, the increasingly evident economic need for successful college students, both for their own lives and for the future of the economy. And affordability, of course, is now symbolically attached very much to worries that people have about student debt, which often dominate both families and political leaders thinking about the needs of higher education. But when the commission got to work, we recognized very quickly that we wanted and we thought the nation needed to think more deeply about success at what and to what end. A conversation that stops with completion and affordability does not really address what it is about what happens in college that is important. We came to see that the question of every student having a high quality learning experience in college underlies all of the concerns about how do you pay for it and how do you get through it successfully. We need to make sure, in our view, that colleges of all kinds, not just elite liberal universities, but everything from community colleges and for-profit institutions to broad access public institutions, private colleges, and the universities, needs to provide education for its students, which is more than simply preparation for a first job or a next job. That is partly because even from a purely material perspective of employment and future success, that job's not going to last very long. And if it does last, it's going to last in a very different form. This is a world of constant change and renovation. And to have a successful career, a successful work life, is going to require resourcefulness, imagination, a capacity to think independently, a capacity to communicate effectively, not only with people who are like you, but with people who are very different from you, and a capacity to solve problems. That deeper conception of what education needs to accomplish, we think, is really important. But it's more than careers. It's much more than careers. College education needs to make its contribution to the civic capacities and the future civic life of our students, and to help them to live more rewarding and richer personal lives. And we don't think this kind of educational ambition should be confined to a narrow few, but should be an ambition that lightens all of higher education. A consequence of this is that, in the commission's view, it's a mistake, it's a false choice to debate vocational versus liberal education. Liberal education traditionally is a way of helping people to develop these broader capacities for critical thinking, communication, problem solving, and reasoning. And even a purist conception of a liberal education needs to confront problems of the present day, even if you're confronting them with writings from the deep past. So we see these components as part of everybody's education. And we think that raises a high bar for what colleges of all kinds should be trying to do. And we came to the view that there are real worries about our colleges falling short particularly in their attention to the quality of teaching and learning that happens on campus. Research, scholarship are incredibly important parts of what the academy provides to society, indispensable parts. Graduate education and research are fundamental. The reality, though, is that most of the work of most faculty members is teaching undergraduates. And that work needs to be done well. And we don't find in our higher education systems, we find too many cases where that work is neglected or taken for granted, where there's no particular concern with training people to teach or helping them to improve teaching over time. Moreover, we need to recognize that the vast majority of undergraduate teaching these days is not done by traditional regular members of the faculty, but by people who are often called adjuncts, who have non-tenure track, often very temporary positions. In many cases, these are very capable people, but they're working under conditions of great stress, often with very little support, and very little promise of improvement in their condition, depending on how well their work goes. So we think it's an imperative, and we think this is a responsibility of the academy, of the full range of college and universities, to build more quality into the way teachers are prepared and the way teachers are rewarded for their work, including those who are not in tenure or tenure track positions. We envision in the future the development of a really professionalized workforce for teaching college in the United States. And teaching in a new century with an extremely more varied student population than many of our current faculty grew up with. There's a lot of learning that needs to be done to make this effective, and we are challenging higher education to take this on in a serious way. Now, that said, it is important for education to be strong in quality, but it is also extremely important that people succeed both in paying for that education and in completing it. One of the things we learned in the commission is that these two imperatives of completion and affordability are actually deeply connected. A simple example is that for many students, a key obstacle to completion is that they work too many hours outside of the classroom, leaving them too little time for study and leaving them exhausted. And they often make that choice because they're afraid of debt. And they're afraid that if they commit to borrowing, they will wreck their futures. A more central affordability problem comes in the problems of students who get in trouble repaying their loans. And this turns out to be deeply connected with the completion agenda. The biggest problems, as we learned in the loan system, are not with the people who have the biggest educational debts. In fact, those people are generally people who've gone on to graduate education and they pay back reliably. The biggest problem, as Roger emphasized, is among those who don't complete their programs. Typical undergraduate load for borrowing is manageable for most students who complete their associate's degree programs or their bachelor's degree programs, or at much less cost, their certificate programs. But it is not manageable for people who drop out. They may borrow less because they don't stay as long, but they have very little capacity to pay back because they haven't achieved the economic benefits that go with a credential. So completion matters, and Roger cited some of the statistics, but it matters not only to individual students, but also to society because of the social justice concerns attached to the concentration of the non-completion problem among populations that are low income, first generation, and students of color. Also, as a successful society, in political and social terms, building a strong population with effective, high-quality education is essential to our future. we commissioned Moody's Analytics to do an analysis of what a 10-year program of investment in better completion for students from disadvantaged backgrounds would do for our economy. And Moody's concluded that over a period of 20 to 25 years, the greater productivity of the workforce that would result from that would generate higher enough growth, about a 10% increase in the rate at which the economy grows annually, to more than pay for the initial investment. This is an investment in the future of our country. Now, the commission offers no magic bullets on either affordability or completion. We do not envision large new infusions of resources from governments or elsewhere, but we do strongly urge that the continued decay in public support for higher education should, if not be turned around, at least be halted. But within the resources that higher education has available, an imperative, we think, a key lesson is focus that money where it will do the most good. Be clear about who needs most help and who is less in need of help, both at an institutional level and at a student level, and use the resources deliberately. That applies to colleges and universities themselves, also to state governments and to the federal government. To improve the prospects of students completing college, we do think that better attention to undergraduate teaching quality is an important component. We've also found that institutions that manage very effectively to track students going through college, to intervene promptly and effectively when students are going off track, can have a really striking impact. Some of the universities in the University Innovation Alliance, as well as community colleges, including CUNY with its ASAP program, have been very effective. Dropping out is expensive. It's expensive for the institution. It's expensive especially for the student and for the student's future life. So this is a key imperative for us. So more than enough from me. Let me turn to my colleagues, and we'll begin with Mitch Daniels.